Following on from my two-part series taking a look at national football teams that are overloaded in one position a couple of months back, long-term subscriber Thomas Minen recently suggested that I take a look at seven national teams who have a real dearth of talent in a specific position. As I said in those previous videos, club sides tend to balance their squads out in transfer windows, giving them a somewhat even spread of talent across the team. International teams, on the other hand, are not afforded that luxury, with managers only able to select players eligible to represent their national team. Just as this results in concentrations of talent in certain areas, it can also lead to obvious weak spots. Naturally, this seven will focus on stronger national teams. I've no doubt that American Samoa don't have a plethora of brilliant false nines, but then again the rest of the team are hardly Ballon d'Or nominees either. Here are seven national teams that are lacking in one position. Croatia, left back. Croatia may only be a country of 4 million people, but the national team reached the final of the 2018 World Cup in Russia, and they're currently considered the 6th best international team on earth by FIFA's world rankings. Croatia's real strength lies in the middle of the park, where they have an embarrassment of riches from Luka Modric and Mateo Kovacic to Ivan Rakitic and Marcelo Brozovic, and the Europeans also have some real danger men going forward. Their biggest weakness is undoubtedly at left back. For 8 years, Ivan Strinic was Croatia's first choice left back, winning 49 caps and starting for the country in every game at the 2018 World Cup. Sadly, in August 2018, shortly after signing for AC Milan, Strinic was found to have a heart condition which forced him to step back from football. He was released by the Milan club in 2019, is now a free agent, and hasn't won a cap for Croatia since the World Cup final. Rangers left-back Borna Barisic looks to be a good bet to inherit the left-back spot in Zlatko Dalic's side now, but the manager clearly isn't fully convinced by the attack-minded fullback. Dynamo Kiev star Josip Pavaric is another candidate, but oftentimes Dalic seems more comfortable shifting Tin Yedvaj over to the problematic position. Yedvaj, who is currently on loan from Bayer Leverkusen at Augsburg, has traditionally played as a centre-back or right-back at club level, but has won a number of his 24 Croatia caps at left-back. Colombia. Central midfield. The beautiful nation of Colombia can boast a couple of excellent attacking midfielders, with Juan Fernando Quintero and starman James Rodriguez both capable of playing in that number 10 role. It is the position just beneath that, in defensive and particularly central midfield, where the South Americans appear to be a little light. In terms of central midfielders, not attacking midfielders, Colombia can only really call upon the likes of Gustavo Cuellar, who plays for Al Hilal in Saudi Arabia, Jefferson Lerma, who plays for Bournemouth, and Matias Uribe, who plays for Porto. They do have a bit more strength in defence midfield with the likes of Wilmer Barrios, Jorman Campuzano, and Carlos Sanchez, but the position still stands out among the weakest in the Colombia squad. Between the sticks, Colombia have David Ospina, they have the likes of Davinson Sanchez, Yerry Mina, and Santiago Arias at the back, and the varied talents of James Rodriguez, Luis Muriel, and Radamel Falcao in attacking areas. So if only they had a top-class anchor and a really good box-to-box player, they could be a real force. Switzerland, centre forward. Benfica fans won't thank me for this, since Haris Seferovic was in lethal form for the Portuguese Giants last season. Personally though, I don't think the 28-year-old is of the required calibre to lead the line for a national team with Switzerland's aspirations. The Swiss are 12th in FIFA's world rankings right now, ahead of Germany and the Netherlands, and they reached the knockout stages of the 2014 World Cup, Euro 2016, and the 2018 World Cup, as well as reaching the finals of the inaugural UEFA Nations League. That is testament to the mini golden generation the Swiss have enjoyed in recent times, boasting a really decent squad without necessarily possessing any true star names. Despite their progress in three successive major tournaments, Switzerland have been dumped out in the quarterfinals on each occasion. In those three knockout ties, Vladimir Petkovic's men have scored just one goal, and it's clear to see that they have lacked the cutting edge required to make it to the latter stages of a major finals. At one time, Brille Mbolo looked like the future of Swiss football and capable of leading their line for the next 10 to 15 years, but poor form and unfortunate injuries have thwarted his progress, and he's only scored 4 international goals. Norwich City striker Josip Dermich has bagged 10 in 35 for Switzerland, but just 1 in 13 for the Canaries this season, is perhaps evidence that he too isn't of international class. Seferovic tends to get the number 9 shirt, with Mario Gavranovic offering some competition, but I think Switzerland's centre-forward struggles are more than worthy of a place in this seven. France, right back. France have by far the most depth of any national team on earth right now, as my previous videos on the opposite of this subject emphatically showed. For almost every position, France have 4 or 5 players who are the envy of the world over. They have centre-backs coming out of their ears, for example, and more left and right wingers than the comment section of a Joe Rogan video about universal basic income. For all of the strength and depth and the embarrassment of riches available to Didier Deschamps across the park, there is one position where Les Bleus are less blessed, and that is at right-back. France do have a few decent right-backs, namely Djibril Sidibé at Everton, Kevin Malcuy at Napoli, and Léa Dubois at Lyon. But the fact that Sidibé has only won 18 caps for France aged 27, Dubois has only won 4 aged 25, and Malcuy hasn't won a single one tells you that none are Didier Deschamps' first choice there. Instead, the two-time World Cup winner, once as a player and once as a manager, has tended to shoehorn one of his other many talented players into that right-back role. Centre-back Benjamin Pavard was Deschamps' go-to right-back at the 2018 World Cup, even scoring arguably one of the goals of the tournament for the eventual winners against Argentina. Pavard has won 27 caps for France, aged 23, and does a sterling job as a fullback, but it isn't his preferred position, and given France's quality everywhere else, their right-back issue is noticeable. Spain. Wingers. I always normally specify a specific position, so left or right wingers, with this type of video, but you can just about take your pick in terms of the flanks when it comes to Spain's options. Spain are a team who have had outrageous depth in midfield for two decades, and they still have a strong back four. Both on the wings and at centre forward though, they don't possess quite the same talent. Isco is probably Spain's best wide player, despite being an attacking midfielder by trade, and then Luis Enrique has a raft of good, but not world-class wide men. The likes of Iñaki Williams, Gerard Deulofeu, Pedro, Pablo Sarabia and José Callejón are all good players, but none, you might suggest, are as good as the likes of Ramos, Piqué, Busquets and Thiago Alcantara are in their positions. Dani Olmo is one Spanish wide player who I've really liked the look of on the rare occasions in which I've watched in this season, but again, he too is primarily an attack midfielder, he's just capable of playing on either flank. Enrique typically likes to counter that by playing two inverted wingers, with Isco, Olmo, Suso and Sarabia occupying those roles in his most recent squads. One ace up their sleeve that Spain could have out wide is Adama Traore, who has added a dollop of end product to his tremendous raw ability this season. He's been called up by Spain, age 24, but is yet to win a senior cap. The Netherlands. Centre forward. The Netherlands actually have a few areas in which I'm sure Ronald Koeman would love to improve, despite having already made vast improvements since their failure to qualify for Euro 2016 and the 2018 World Cup. Despite historically being such a great, free-flowing attacking outfit, one of the Netherlands' primary weak spots right now is at centre-forward. Koeman's men look well-equipped at centre-back, in central midfield and in the wide areas, but at left-back, right-back and centre-forward, they're just a little way behind the real powerhouses on the international stage right now. In terms of out-and-out centre-forwards, the leading lights for the Netherlands would be Wout Weghorst, who is having a very good season at Wolfsburg, Bas Dost, who has also made a decent start to life in the Bundesliga, and Luke de Jong, who has scored 6 in 31 since joining Sevilla in the summer. You could make a bold case for 36-year-old Klaas-Jan Huntelaar still being a better marksman than all three, although the veteran Ajax star hasn't won a cap for Holland since 2015. The Dutch typically tend not to play any of their tailor-made strikers, Weghorst has only won 3 caps, Dost none since 2018, and De Jong only 22 in total, aged 29, and instead opt to play Memphis Depay through the middle. The Lyon star, who is currently sidelined with a lengthy injury, is the Netherlands' highest scoring active international, but he isn't a born centre-forward, and at times the Netherlands can look a little toothless going forward. Argentina. Right back. It has long been joked in footballing circles that Argentina have the front end of a Ferrari and the back end of that Fiat out of the in-betweeners, with the likes of Lionel Messi, Sergio Aguero and Paulo Dybala as options going forward, meanwhile Nicolas Otamendi is arguably their most formidable defender. And he isn't very good. As such, Argentina could feature in this seven for their problems at left-back, centre-back or right-back, but I think they're particularly lacking in the right-back position. Whilst Nicolas Tagliafico is their obvious starter at left-back, just who takes up that right-back spot is a dilemma for Lionel Scaloni. Experienced fullback Gabriel Mercado is arguably still Argentina's best right-back. He played there for Albis Celeste at the 2018 World Cup, but he's won just one cap since 2018 and now plays his club football in Qatar. Then you have the likes of Leonardo Godoy, Renzo Saravia and Leonardo Jara, all decent right-backs, but nowhere near the level of Argentina's forward players. Saravia is the only one of them to have been capped, just 9 times, as Argentina typically tend to shoehorn a centre-back or right midfielder into right-back. Tottenham utility man Juan Foyth has been one of the main men to fill that void, despite not looking entirely comfortable at fullback. Meanwhile, Independiente right-sided midfielder Fabricio Bustos has also filled in there a few times. Whichever way you swing it, Argentina are a car crash defensively, and particularly at right back. That's it for today's video. There are plenty more teams and positions I had jotted down in my notes, so should this video knock out of the park, I'd be more than willing to make a part 2. Thank you all for watching, I hope you have a tremendous day, and feel free to hit that like button and subscribe to HITC Sevens if for some reason you'd like to see more of me in the future.